You grew up in Islington, in a, as I understand, in an architectural household, or not?
That's right, yeah. That's true. My dad was an architect, and his uncle was an architect as well, which is quite weird. So I am actually part of a weird dynasty. My mum was a doctor, and I mean, sometimes I actually think maybe I would have been a better surgeon or something, but, you know, that's for fantasy really now.
Because that's interesting, because I have a fantasy still about being a surgeon.
Do you?
Because my family were all doctors.
Perhaps that would have been a fulfilling job. But I don't
Why know. Did you choose to do architecture?
Do you know what? I really don't know. I think probably I was really influenced by my father's work. He used to bring back from work these, you know, big die lines and split them up and use it. We used it for drawing and painting. And I remember looking at the back of these things and looking at his blueprints and thinking, that's really interesting, and being able to read them without any problem at all, you know, understand the plan and all the rest, and I just got quite intrigued.
Did you ever have any sense then that architecture could be a vehicle for societal change?
None at all.
You've talked about when you studied architecture, you felt as if the people teaching you and the concerns of architecture were alien to you as a woman.
Well, just to put it in context, when I went to Cambridge, 5 colleges were admitting women, so not very many. And, you know, it's full of privilege as well, and I didn't feel that privileged. I mean, I realise I am now, but I didn't at the time. I felt very disadvantaged because I hadn't been to public school, I didn't speak with the right accent and stuff like that. Then in the architecture school, I mean, I was only taught by men, so actually sort of finding your place and finding a voice really to speak about things that might be of interest to you that were not of interest to others, it was very, very difficult to do, I thought.
Did you nearly quit as an undergraduate?
I nearly quit in the second year. I just couldn't get a grasp of what it was all about. And actually, I felt it was worse than that, that there was somehow some kind of cabalistic knowledge that was held by people that they wouldn't give up, and that you had to try and grasp on your own. And I mean, in a way, that's a good model of teaching because it makes you quite resourceful about finding out the answers to the problems. You know, you're not going to be handed it in on a plate. But at the same time, it was also quite dogmatic and made very clear what the value system was. I'm getting the sense all the time that somehow I'm having to get access to this kind of knowledge, but actually it's sort of meaningless knowledge to me because I can't locate it within my own experience. And so, I don't know, all of these things sort of came together to make me feel very unwelcome, really, and just couldn't get a foothold in it at all.
Did you feel like an outsider then?
Total outsider, yeah.
An imposter.
In all sorts of ways. For me, it's about how you value the knowledge, you know, what knowledge is valuable and kind of meaningful to you as a designer. And that's what we wanted to do in this project as well, sort of think about different kinds of knowledge, different kind of aesthetic, sort of mix it up a bit in order to kind of question those sort of inherited orthodoxies.
Thank you. Actually, it's the first new building I have ever built. Mainly up till now, it's been, you know, refurbishments, renovations, working with existing buildings.
It's like a kind of first novel or something. The first novel is normally about the person's, you know, life. It's kind of semi-autobiographical. And they put in almost everything they know into the first novel. And it's a kind of thing like that with the first building often. And that is seen as a sort of closet criticism, whereas I think it's fantastic, you know. I mean, I have no shame that it's got so much going on in it.
In a way, there are lots of ideas in the house that express many of those that you've been talking about. But how did you begin to understand what you might do here?
Jeremy and I had been living in a house in Upper Holloway where my office was in the attic, and we'd been living there for about 12 years. So we were used to the idea of living and working on the same site. And we thought that might be interesting to transpose into Stock Orchard Street. And having thought about that, we then thought, well, we're really interested in sustainability, so we'll sort of layer that into it as well. And we began to think about orientation, about the other environmental problems of the site, like the fact that there's a retaining wall to the north and there's the railway out to the east. And, you know, how are we going to deal with these quite pragmatic technical issues, vibration being one of them?
But then there were lots of, what would you call it, sort of fantasy things, because We're two architects, and as you know, there's kind of a bit of competition between architects about how you work together and who claims authorship and, you know, puts the marks on the page and stuff like that. So we made a rule that we would only talk about it and we wouldn't draw anything at all. And you know, we would come up, we'd go on holiday and think, oh, I really like, let's do that, you know, that kind of thing. Let's put a tower in, you know, let's have a this, that, whatever. And at the time, the idea was to try and bring together the promise of architectural discourse and what it could herald with the pragmatics of architecture. So we thought, well, we'll see if we could really push the boat out. And the original intention was to build a house, just a simple house. When we discovered that we owned this patch of land along the railway line, we began to think, well, maybe we could do a bit more than that. And wouldn't it be great to maybe build an office, because then it could be our pension and stuff like that, and I could move my office in there. So the whole brief began to expand. And at that point, I thought it kind of hit an interesting moment, because, I mean, basically, it's my house and my office, and so there's a big autobiographical component in all of that, which is, you know, my role as housekeeper, occupant, female leader of a practice, and so forth. And where is it that I'm creative, where is it, what role am I playing in various different parts of the building? And that's when the sort of feminist agenda kind of kicked in. Years ago, you looked at a photograph of the kind of desirable home, and it would have glass balustrades and it would have sort of glazing and lots of it, and everything would look very slick and shiny, and everything in its place. And I would always be thinking, who's cleaning that? You know, what work is involved in actually keeping that world the way that it is?
And also, why should it be clean and sanitized?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, who's being exploited, if you like, in this world? And as the householder, you know, I'm thinking, well, actually, it's me.
You could also argue, why couldn't the architecture take that mess?
Well, exactly. And so we did begin to ask that, why, you know, why is this thing held up as being so fantastic when it's so exploitative? And it's kind of chasing all the wrong things somehow. That allied with the interest in the everyday, and, you know, sort of relaxing about the mess and the dirt and not worrying about it, became very embedded in this project.
And suddenly it kind of all popped out, you know. This was going to be a barrier, a noise barrier against the railway line, but we would make it acoustically workable, you know, that the bedrooms would be at the far end. So very, very pragmatic, you know, away from the railway so you wouldn't get disturbed by it at night.
There's almost a diagram in there.
Yeah. And then, you know, then we wanted to address the street and the fact that this is quite a sort of performative space, which, you know, is the only really big window that gives onto that street.
And spatially, I mean, next door, where does the house begin in your mind?
Well, it really begins here. And I mean, part of that is because it's so really enormous as a space for two people, to be quite honest. But the whole way that it's organised is that you've got these sort of little bits of space which you can carve up and kind of inhabit in different ways. So this is quite intimate because it's underneath the mezzanine, and so that's just a nice place for kind of reading a book, quite good light, you know, or an intimate conversation. This is about being a bit more sociable. But I mean, equally, this has been over here at times and vice versa. That's now become a bit of a telly corner.
But you inhabit bits of it. I mean,
Definitely. We move around depending on mood completely, yes.
Yeah. And light, time of day.
And light, and exactly. So and intimacy and warmth. Or if you really want to get away, you go up to the top of the tower and you've got the little eyrie right at the top that overlooks the railway line, and you're not really connected with anything there. So you see the rhythm of the city, but there's no Wi-Fi, there's no phone, you know, it's completely sort of hermetic, which is really nice. So you've got these different ways of being that kind of reflect your mood or what you're trying to do.
Tell me about the history of this site and how it changed over many years.
I mean, it had been cattle pens and rendering yards, and we think that those houses were probably connected with the railway line because they came along when that came. So having been a place of kind of gathering cattle and I suppose industrial being in cattle, then it became a forge, a working forge, and they were making these strip leaf springs. But when we bought it, they were still making leaf springs, but they were for vintage vehicles and taxis. And that connects with those yards at the top, because what they would do is bring the taxis in to get their springs fitted, then send them back up the street to get them repaired and get their bodywork done. Anyway, long story short, when we moved in and the forge moved out to an industrial site on the North London line, then we returned it back to being housing and a productive garden. So in a way, it's come full circle, which I really like.
What I hadn't appreciated was that sense of the front and the back, the house kind of straddling both, you know, and the theatrical nature of the room, the conference room, but also this is a kind of piece of theatre, isn't it?
It totally is, and you know, the neighbours all garden in different ways, and you've got my neighbour Anne-Marie, who's got her washing out there, and her husband, who laid tennis courts for a living, you know, climbed up the tree to put that thing in, and she reels it in and out, and it's just great. It's a theatre of life going on in front of you. It's really, I love it.
But in a way, you could argue, of course, that the backs of buildings are always more interesting.
They are.
I sort of wonder whether the whole of this building has been conceived of as a back.
Well, it is in a way, because there's a funny thing, isn't there, going on, that the front is the back, because there isn't really a back at all. So, you know, you come in through the front garden. It's a very unusual arrangement for an urban building, actually.
And then straw bale. I mean, this is that wall that supposedly wasn't how you're supposed to do it.
That's right. But the whole idea here was to put the bales on display, because otherwise you wouldn't really know that they were there at all, and sort of watch how they performed. Mm. And I mean, I think actually they've done pretty well. They're now about 24 years old.
There's also a kind of curious inversion of this modernist idea that when you expose the making of something, you did it in that beautifully crafted kind of high-tech tensioned cables, whereas here, the kind of off-the-shelf straps and screws and things are on display, which I like.
Absolutely. And also you see the wonkiness of the bales and how ragged each of them is and so on. And, you know, I mean, it's just sort of putting the guts out there to kind of, I suppose, debunk the myth that it's actually a very complicated process, which it isn't really. Mm. And in fact, bales are very easy to learn to build with. And I mean, it's a shame that they're not more fully adopted, really.
Do you think that, I mean, architects think of themselves as incredibly liberal, kind of open-minded people, but do you think that people were genuinely confronted by this building when you made it 20 years ago?
Oh, definitely, yeah. Aesthetically, I think it looks very different from most what was being built at the time.
Because it wasn't slick and ordered.
Yes, and the materials that we used were unusual, haven't been seen before largely. I mean, like back cloth quilting and stuff like that. It looks a bit disorderly. There's quite a lot of different materials, so perhaps it looks a bit incoherent or cacophonous or whatever the words are. So, you know, people have accused this building of looking really messy, that it doesn't look like it's got real estate value, thus the comment about tidying up the elevations, those kinds of things, you know, doesn't look gilt-edged at all. And Max Hutchinson on, Radio London said, why would you want to have your granny's knickers, clad in your building? I mean, it's that kind of thing. It just looks aesthetically not
It's also
very
interesting because it was designed in a way that belies the image. I mean, most buildings, I think, specifically, particularly nowadays, are designed that can be image-led, and you can photograph it, understand it, and communicate it in a single image, whereas this building doesn't allow you to do that.
Not at all, and I think you understand this building through moving through it.
But how do those really haptic things that I'm also interested in fit with a political agenda? I mean, this building, for example, seems to be a kind of marriage of those two ideas. You know, the haptic material, we can see the light, see the kind of, you know, there's a very textured and layered material experience of being in this building. And at the same time, there's a kind of deeply political agenda that sits comfortably alongside that. How do you marry those two things?
It's not a question of sort of minimizing it to a kind of core. For me, it's more about a kind of layering or a sort of palimpsest of a series of ideas, which, you know, to lots of people might be very baggy and quite incoherent and all the rest of it. But actually, you know, the flip side of the coin is it could be regarded as richness or, embracing a range of different things all simultaneously. And I think in a way I'm much more interested in that. And I don't really care if it's incoherent, actually.
Well, it's kind of
what
like
does it mean to be incoherent? I mean, whose incoherence is it?
Well, also, you know, like, simplicity is always a virtue in architecture. It's like, but if architecture is a vehicle to tell stories, why do you always have to tell a simple story?
One story, you could tell multiple stories. Exactly. No, I mean, I'm really into that. And in fact, somebody said about this building that it's like high cholesterol architecture, and I thought, yeah, why not? You know, just layer it on, kind of thing.
But in other disciplines, other cultural disciplines, or other creative disciplines, we're far more used to something having kind of multiple narratives, multiple meanings, multiple interpretations.
I agree. Yet,
in architecture, there still prevails that orthodox, the dogma of the diagram.
I know, what is that? I mean, is it because it's so complex as an art that, you know, one feels that one's only control is to edit it all down and kind of show, you know, how your mastery over it? But I mean, again, I'm very critical of ideas of kind of mastery as well. I mean, what does it mean to master something? I don't really know. I mean, I feel, you know, practice is that, is practice, isn't it? It's like you're still, it's all very provisional and you're learning all the time and it's all really fluid and, you know, things you took for granted get questioned by X or Y and suddenly you're thinking, well, maybe that isn't the way to go. I think it's quite amusing that architects get very kind of upset about their buildings being changed, because to me that's goes with the territory. I mean, you know, you don't own it once you've left it. And even if, like in this building, you know, it's not precious enough to feel it has to be an aspect. You know, it's a constant evolution that responds to you at the time. And I think all architecture ought to be like that.
Really? I mean, even looking at the buildings up and down the street here, you know, these buildings have layers of change, you know, all over them. Yeah. And we forget that, I think. And I think part of the fear, though, is that, you know, we design things that can't change, because if we design things that can't change, we can control it. And particularly in the, you know, we're in denial of those processes, I think. You were a youngish designer when you designed this place, and you've your whole practice, or you know, 4/5 of your practice has been lived out in this building. Yeah. And how do you think you have evolved as a designer in the intervening period?
Well, let's just put it this way. I mean, one of the things I learned was actually to make it simpler, because, I mean, some of the problems we've had in detailing this are because it was just incredibly complicated. And I think
But when you're young, you don't care how complicated
you don't,
you have
Well,
the
you don't.
To...
You're not. Well, and also you're learning. I mean, this was the first building that I think new building that I ever built. So of course I'm learning, you know, and I mean, the great thing is, in a way, that I'm not going to get sued because it's my building, and so I just have to fix it, you know, and you learn through doing that. And if I think back about it, if I had this opportunity to buy this site and do this building now, I probably wouldn't have the energy. So it's about trying to concentrate my resources into the things I think I really want to do at this stage in my life. One of the things I think this building gave us as a practice was kind of put a lot of stuff, gathered a lot of capital in my bank, if you know what I mean, both technical knowledge and sort of the kind of designer I wanted to be and the things I was interested in particular the everyday. You know, I want to make everyday worlds better. You know, it's the worlds we inhabit all the time, not the rarefied stuff, the art galleries or the things you visit occasionally, but how, you know, civic life, if you like, is played out against this backdrop of things that you encounter in your everyday world that, you know, I think is a right of everybody to have the best that you can get.
And it's something as a society we've forgotten about, it feels. I mean, you know, it feels that I mean, again, I'm nervous about saying things used to be better, but when I look at the city, what I see is a kind of emotional and financial investment in the everyday. You know, railway stations or hospitals or schools or roads or streets are, you know, were invested in as a set of ideas that could form the basis of a kind of civic society.
Yeah.
And that doesn't exist now, you know.
Not really.
I think it's a big problem.
Not really. I agree with you, and I think there's a danger that we're going down a route whereby only if you can afford it do you deserve it. And I don't think that's a great model for a civic society. I don't have the formula. I mean, we're living it all the time.
But no one has the formula.
No, exactly. So we just try our best and keep practicing.
You carry on. Do you want to come and see the model?
We see it all when it's done anyway. We saw it before the sun started.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, it was a real mess. Oh, it looks nice.
Yeah.
When it's all done, I'll come in and have a look at it then.
Yeah.
I'll go home. Okay. Bye.
See you.
Bye-bye.
Okay. Yeah.